for this broadcast is brought to you by the Rodriguez Foundation and from viewers like you.
Born in 1910, John Henry Hammond II was the youngest with four older sisters from a wealthy New York family with a fortune which came from his great-grandfather on his mother's side, William Henry Vanderbilt.
We had a sort of a large house on 91st Street. We had about 15 servants. They had their own Columbia Graffanola down in the servants' quarters, and so I used to spend a lot of my time down there, too.
As a teenager, he would often leave his large house and walk from 95th Street to 116th Street in Harlem.
The house was so big, the family never knew whether I was in or not, and I used to sneak out of school and either walk or take a trolley to the middle of Harlem and just roam around.
Yes, John Hammond was an overprivileged white male from one of the richest and well-connected families in the country and therefore the world. But who better to make things happen than a man from an aristocracy?
We've already mentioned among the names that you are credited with discovering was Billie Holiday.
And I hate to say the word discover, you know.
Well, all right. You give me a better one.
I latched onto him, all right.
Okay. All right, but it was only around the age of 20 or so that you first heard Billie Holiday.
Yeah, she was 17 and I was 22.
22.
Long time, now baby or never.
I heard a singer who was an improvising horn player.
Horn player?
Yeah, well that's how she sounded. She would take a pop tune, sing it at each table, and she'd sing it entirely differently every time.
Around the same time as recording Fletcher Henderson and Bessie Smith, one night, Hammond was going to a Harlem nightclub to hear a singer by the name of Monette Moore. Monette didn't sing that night, but was replaced by a young 17-year-old Billie Holiday.
He'd never heard an improvising singer like that.
And the 18-year-old Billie cut her first record.
You don't have to have a hanker to be a broker or banker. No, the reason you'll simply be.
Hammond integrated the session by including an obscure white clarinetist named Benny Goodman.
Benny was making his living as a sideman in New York. Of course, those were all white bands, and Benny said if it was known that he played with black guys, he would be barred from further work.
Oh, oh, well, it's tight like that.
When Goodman was still relatively unknown, Hammond introduced him to Fletcher Henderson.
Fletcher Henderson, as a leader, he was the one man who made full use of all the improvising soloists that he had in the band.
And nobody had any idea, or average person didn't have any idea of changing this thing. So the rebel was John Hammond.
If I was going to break the color line, Teddy would be the guy who could keep up with Benny every which way and perhaps he'd even be a little ahead of him.
And that began the recordings of the Benny Goodman Trio.
When musician Mary Lou Williams told Hammond about a young man in Oklahoma City who played an electrically amplified guitar, he immediately arranged for Charlie Christian to travel to Los Angeles and audition for Goodman. That night, Hammond arranged to have Christian on the bandstand without Goodman's knowledge.
Benny got on the stand, and he took a look down, and there was Charlie Christian. So he looked at Charlie, and Charlie looked up, and first there was one chorus, and then there was two choruses, and finally, after about 16 choruses, the place was in an uproar.
After traveling around with Goodman and hearing the same tunes over and over, one evening in January of 1936, Hammond went out to his car and turned the dial all the way to the end and heard a different sound.
In a band that I had not heard of, from the Reno Club in Kansas City. And I couldn't believe it. It was Count Basie and his orchestra. So I started writing Basie letters at the Reno Club, and I never heard of word.
So finally, one night, I looked up and John was sitting alongside of me.
The influence and the impact that John Hammond has on American culture, He revolutionized jazz. He brought it to the forefront by integrating it, making it truly an American art form. It's American classical music. We never think of it in that term, but this is a sophisticated thing.
All of Hammond's discoveries and influence culminated in Hammond's promotion of a concert that took place in the most unlikely venue, Carnegie Hall. A place where his mother would bring him and his sisters to hear classical music. A concert hall with walls that had never reflected the sound of jazz or blues. With his family being a longtime supporter of Carnegie Hall, with their own family box seats, Hammond's influence and connections drew another first.
The fact that Carnegie Hall, the epitome of high culture, would have a jazz concert was enough to give jazz that kind of legitimacy. And it showed, as I think perhaps nothing had before or since, John's scope.
It was called From Spirituals to Swing. Hammond not only brought great jazz, but also showed the world everything from gospel choirs, the Delta blues, to boogie-woogie piano. One of those people that was inspired by this concert was Alfred Lion, who would take this inspiration and start Blue Note Records. During the 50s, Hammond once again found himself drawn to the unpopular music. He found himself listening to the songs of Pete Seeger. Finally, in 1958, he got a call from Godard Lieberson with an offer to come back to Columbia Records. Within 2 years back at Columbia, Hammond discovered another legend in the making and signed her in 1960.
Decided they could sell a million records with her as a pop singer. I said, you're going to destroy this girl because this is an earthy gospel singer with great blues overtones. And so there were fights and everything. And he took, so Dave took Aretha away from me completely.
Only a year after signing Aretha, Hammond signs Dylan.
Round the poverty shack, they look from the crack to the track. And the hoofbeats pounding his brain.
I was a social activist, and I wanted to change the world. And I loved any artist who felt he wanted to change the world, too. And Bobby was one of the first, really, that I came up against. And I was sort of, delighted with what I saw. I said, Jesus, I wonder if he can, I wonder if he writes. So I then asked him if he did, and he said, yeah. So I knew, we just had to sign him, that it was just anti-establishment enough so that he could write, that he was a poet, you know. What more did I want to wait for?
The fact that John had offered me the contract and opportunity to record, I mean, that was just a phenomenal thing back then.
The 60s was an extremely productive decade for Hammond. He produced over 100 albums, including the 30th anniversary of From Spirituals to Swing. He also created a reissue program at Columbia that introduced a new generation to classic blues and jazz artists. One of those reissues in particular was that of forgotten blues legend Robert Johnson. Hammond convinced Columbia record execs that it was essential to reissue a compilation of old 78s and call it King of the Delta Blues Singers.
Suzanne.
After hearing Leonard Cohen at a few Newport folk festivals, John Hammond signed him to Columbia in 1967. After a decade of amazing work, John Hammond was introduced to another young singer from New Jersey.
Our next performer is a very fine young songwriter, Bruce Springsteen.
This first song is a song about being new in town.
I was broke, I didn't have any dough, and I had nothing going. It was just the biggest thrill of my life. I mean, the day I came to your office.
I asked you a question. I said, Bruce, have you ever written anything you wouldn't dare record? He said, yes, as a matter of fact, I have. I got a song called If I Was the Priest.
Well, sweet Virgin Mary, she runs the Holy Grail Saloon. Well, for a nickel, I'll give you whiskey and a personally blessed balloon.
So I said, Bruce, were you brought up by nuns? And he said, of course.
Oh, God.
And so then that gave me a whole new perspective on, you know, you and what we might be able to do.
And Mary serves mass on Sunday, and then she sells the body on Monday.
With over 50 years in the music industry, John Hammond retired in 1975. Well, Columbia forced him to retire. He also never received any royalties for any of the albums he produced, thinking the artist deserved to retain the money. Well into his retirement, John Hammond heard one last artist. In 1983, he heard Stevie Ray Vaughan. He brought Stevie to the attention of Greg Geller, the head of A&R at Epic Records. John Henry Hammond II only lived a few more years, passing away after a series of strokes in 1987. When the coroners got there, he was listening to Billie Holiday.
The following conversation is between Mikey Harris and I. The woman in the picture is Mikey Harris. Mikey Harris was John Hammond Sr.'s assistant at CBS Records and Columbia Records. In fact, she was John Hammond's only tenured assistant at CBS Records the last 10 years of his career at CBS. The following conversation is conversation between her and I, and the conversation took place a couple months before I filed my lawsuit against Bob Dylan. She was being very cautious because they had already read my book 11 years. She couldn't deny the fact that I worked with John Hammond because of documentation. She downplayed it as much as she could, saying that we didn't work together that much. However, the documentation proves that we worked together for 7.5 years. After Mr. Hammond passed, I continued working with CBS for another 4 years through Anthony Tiller. The documentation consisted of letters between Mikey and I and Mr. Hammond's office and I. She does, however, talk about a contract between her and I. Mikey was given production credits on Stevie Ray Vaughan's first album. Mr. Hammond, John Hammond, was listed as executive producer, and Mikey Harris was given credit as assistant producer.